Laurel Thatcher Ulrich holds degrees from University of New Hampshire, University of Utah, and Simmons College. She is the 300th anniversary university professor at Harvard. That doesn't mean you're 300 or been there 300 years,
yeah,
right?
No,
okay, that's... and past president of the American Historical Association. MacArthur Fellow, she worked on the PBS documentary based on A Midwife's Tale, and we hold, hand me that, the two there, yeah, that, yep, and The Midwife's Tale. Most of you already know that Laurel won the Pulitzer Prize for A Midwife's Tale. As I understand it, there have only been two Mormon authors that have won the Pulitzer. Merlo Pusey is the other. So it's quite an honor. She also, for that book, won the Bancroft Prize, John H. Dunning Prize, Joan Kelly Memorial Prize, and a number of other prizes. You can definitely say it's a prize-winning book. And she also started to say work on the PBS documentary based on A Midwife's Tale. I won't do the website because you won't remember it anyway. She's also past president of the Mormon History Association. the book that you've come to hear about tonight, A House Full of Females, Plural Marriage and Women's Rights in Early Mormonism, 1835 to 1870. It's a beautiful book, inside and out. And I'm pretty picky when it comes to how books are put together, being in this business for over 40 years. And this is, it's a dream of a book. Richard Brown calls this a remarkable labor of love, and notes that Laurel's close and insightful reading of diaries and letters, especially in addition to a wealth of other records, including an extraordinary quilt. So if you haven't read the book yet, you'll read about the quilt. Enable her to convey an appreciation of why Mormons committed to their faith despite frequent persecution and privation. The Publishers Weekly calls it impeccable scholarship and a fascinating topic. And then our own Jerry Johnson that I introduced in his column said, so much has been written about plural marriage that no one book could ever become the last and definitive word on the subject. But I guarantee Ulrich's book will change the way you look at the practice for the rest of your life. Now, there's a lot more in there besides just plural marriage, but it's an important book, I feel very privileged to introduce to you Laurel Thatcher Ulrich, who I've known for many years, and we've been at Mormon History Association meetings and so on. I am in awe of her scholarship and her abilities, and I'm so grateful that she's here to share those with us tonight. I know it's warm, sorry, but a little less hot air now that I've stopped talking. Don't nod your head. Is everyone, are people standing by choice or are we out of chairs?
We're out of chairs.
Okay.
Floor?
We'll see if we can scrounge a few more together. Okay, there's two or three up here in the front if somebody wants to come. I realize that, well, you probably saw my best side back here, but there's one back here.
We've got two out of your office, we can put them right here.
Okay, we can put a couple more in our office area. Like I said, this is for us a good problem to have. I apologize for any inconvenience. We'll see if we can get a chair for everyone or close to everyone.
And,
if you have to stand, you get an extra Tootsie Roll. Are those making their way around, by the way, the Tootsie Rolls and the Werthers? Okay. Were you picked up?
We're going to see if this mic is working, is it? Can you hear? Way back there? Okay. Terrific. Thank you. Thank you for coming. I was talking to one of my colleagues a professor at the Harvard Divinity School recently. Some of you may know her. Many years ago, she gave a lecture at Mormon History Association. Name's Kathy Breckus. Some of you know Kathy. And she was talking about what a wonderful experience she had had talking to an audience interested in Mormon history. You know, there's history and there's history. And it's pretty exciting when those of us who work in the academy and teach at universities can encounter a public that really cares about their past. And that is true for this community here. Well, I know you come from lots of different dimensions of relationships to Utah and to Mormonism, but we're united here tonight with our love of history. So I'm going to talk for a little while about this book. It's kind of a risky thing to do because so many of you have already bought the book. I don't want you to ask for a refund. So I'll try to be careful. I thought I would start just by explaining the title. Some people have found that a bit of a tongue twister, have a house full of. We don't use that word female a lot. The girls or women or whatever. But a house full of females is a quotation from the diary of Wilford Woodruff. And on a February day in 1857, as he made his daily diary entry, he noted the house was full of females. Now, I love that. As soon as I read that, I felt like I had the title for my book. Because what do you think of? You think of plural marriage, right? And Wilford Woodruff had three wives at that point and was in the process of acquiring a fourth. But he was not talking about his own household. He had been to the 14th Ward Meeting House in Salt Lake City to a meeting of the Female Relief Society. And the house, meaning the meeting house, was full of females. His wife, his first wife, his legal wife, Phoebe Carter Woodruff, was the Relief Society president. And it's quite likely that on that day, when he visited the Female Relief Society, they were working on the magnificent 14th Ward album quilt. Some of you have seen Carol Nielsen's fabulous book. With Carol's permission, I have picked up on her work and done somewhat more with that quilt, and it shows up in one of the chapters of the book. Now, why was I attracted to this ambiguous quotation? It's because I have long been fascinated with the relationship between women in the household or in families and women who are active in a larger community or public sphere. And so the title captured for me that very interesting dynamic. Tomorrow night I'm going to talk quite a bit about the framing of the book around an event in 1870 when Mormon plural wives defended their marital practices and also stood up as women with 3,000 to 4,000 people in the tabernacle, all women, proclaiming to a national audience their commitment to their faith. And that was the month that the Utah Territorial Legislature granted them the vote. The first in the nation to vote, and 50 years before the national suffrage amendment. So this public life of women and the private or familial life of women was what engaged me in this book. But this is not a book that picks up from 1870 and goes on to talk about all the wonderful things they did. Those of you who read a lot of Mormon history know about plural wives going to medical school and other woman's exponent, all those things. My book is different. I wanted to know, how did they get there? How did they go from perfectly ordinary 19th century women into a religious community that asked them to practice polygamy? And what on earth did that have to do, if anything, with their emergence in the national scene? So my book goes back to 1835 and then comes forward and ties the knot at the end in 1870. Now, I've had several of you this evening say, I have a whole shelf of books on polygamy. So I thought maybe I ought to say what's different about this book. I think this connecting these two themes may be a bit different. But the other reason that this may be different is that it was self-consciously written not for you, but for a broader national audience. It's a trade book from a major publisher. And so there are things in here you will already know about, those of you that have a shelf full of books on polygamy. And also, there will be missing pieces. And there will be missing pieces because I have framed this study in a somewhat unusual way for Mormon scholarship on plural marriage. And of course, that there's a vast range of that, from the fabulous demographic studies of Ben Benyon to, you know, Linton Newell's biography of Emma Smith, and I won't start to name them because you know them. They're wonderful books. But this is a book based on day-to-day accounts that are describing events at the same time they're happening, not decades later. I did not use those fabulous memoirs that were collected in the 19th century and on into the 20th century. I didn't use the articles in the Women's Exponent recollecting the early days in the church. I wanted to know what people were saying at the time, 1835 to 1870, and not just daily diaries, but autograph albums, anything that was dated, little tokens and gifts that they passed. The quilt is dated. Every square on the 1870 quilt is dated. I can situate each of the details in this book and each of the stories in the time in which the events occurred. Now, that doesn't mean that as a historian, I think that diaries are more truthful than as told you reminiscences from the past. They're not. People leave things out of diaries. They're not more truthful. But they're really important because I wanted to understand the creation of something. And diarists and other day-to-day accounts didn't know how things were going to turn out. They weren't looking back, trying to explain themselves in retrospect. They're puzzled, they're confused, they write things down as they understand them at the time. And that was transformative for me when I made that decision. Because we tend to write about Mormonism, or Mormon culture, or Mormon faith, as though it came as a package. And yet we all know it was created. And it was created over a very relatively short period of time. So how did that happen? The second thing that's different is my focus is on women. Now, to elaborate, I'm interested in relationships among women and relationships between women and men. So there are men's diaries in this book. In fact, the book is framed with the words of Wilford Woodruff. If those of you who have your book open it up, you'll see that the end papers are a much enlarged version of a very famous page from Wilford Woodruff's diary. So Wilford's diary, because it's continuous for the whole period, is the kind of spine or sashings on my quilt. And the other diaries come and go. I'm writing about women who were famous, some of them, to you at least, and women who are little known. But trying to begin with Wilford Woodruff coming into Kirtland in 1835, returning from his first mission, an old bachelor at the age of 30. And he meets an old maid at the age of 30, Phoebe Carter. And they marry in Kirtland. The second chapter also deals with their marriage, but he's in England, and she's in what's known as the half-breed tract on the Mississippi River. And so I look at a marriage, and I kind of argue in there that before polygamy was emerged at all, Mormonism began to stretch the definition of a marriage or a family. And then in the next chapter, I begin to get some women's diaries. I have Phoebe Woodruff's letters in chapters 1 and 2, and they're very important. But the women's voices begin to emerge bit by bit, and then one will drop out and another will come in, and we'll follow those diaries through time. I want to give you two short excerpts from the book to give you an idea of the range of kinds of materials and topics that I used. I could just, by way of preface, say there are 15 chapters in this book, plus an introduction, and 6 of those 15 chapters deal primarily with Utah. So this is a book about Mormonism that doesn't just begin in, you know, the classic places. It's a book about Mormonism that follows the people who left the diaries. So I was saying to my sister, it stretches from coastal Maine to Calcutta. And it literally does. And I have a whole chapter from Caroline Crosby's fabulous diary in San Francisco and San Bernardino. So I'm trying to destabilize the way at least I grew up thinking about Mormonism. Thinking of it from the vantage point of the followers, not the prophets. From the vantage point of incremental and painful change over time, and from the vantage point of a global church from the beginning that is trying to reach out, gather people, and bring them into a central place, which is what, of course, gets them into all the trouble. Because once they're massed in one place, there is trouble, as you know. Okay, so this is a very, very, those of you who know my other work know that I love minutiae. I love the tiny little details of people interacting around common events. So I want to give you an example of that. Lots of the diaries I used have been transcribed and published and edited, although I went to the original diaries and worked with them as much as possible, because so much of the knowledge is in the actual physicality of the manuscript diary. But there's one diary that I can't claim I discovered it, but I haven't seen anybody else use it, and I felt like a discovery because I stumbled onto it quite by accident while looking for something else. And that is a fascinating little diary kept by, I don't know how to pronounce her name actually, maybe somebody else can help me, Azuba Woodruff, who was Wilford Woodruff's mother. And his stepmother, literally, but he was only a year old when his biological mother died. And so Azubah essentially raised him. And in this, these pages here, the end papers in, or in the book, he's describing the baptism of his stepmother and father and what that meant to him. He tried so hard to convert all of his relatives. And after Joseph Smith's death, as the church began to move out of Nauvoo, Wilford and Phoebe Woodruff returned from England, where they had been, joined the migration across Iowa. And on their way from England, they stopped in Connecticut and persuaded Wilford's parents to come with them west. It was just a total triumph in Woodruff's thinking. And it was one of those events that he felt like he had accomplished something important. He was going to save his family. But by the time, and now I'm going to read a little bit, by the time the Woodruff wagons reached Mount Pisgah, a little Mormon temporary settlement in Iowa, Azubah had enough. Mother Woodruff handed me a lengthy epistle of complaint written in a book of 30 pages against several persons, their treatment of her, etc. When he referred to several persons, he was protecting Phoebe, who was the target of almost all of Azubah's complaints. He refused to take his stepmother's grievances seriously. Her complaints, he wrote in his diary, were like a tempest in a teapot or a bubble not worthy of notice. The more I have provided for her of late, the more she has complained. She has manifested much of a spirit of fault-finding and watching for iniquity since she came to Nauvoo. He blamed it on the influence of his only sister, Eunice, and her husband, Dwight Webster, who Woodruff said had turned Strangites. And for those of you who don't know, that's a competing faction that emerged after Joseph Smith's death. So I knew this passage in the diary. I was fascinated by the passage in the diary. One day I'm working in an account book that had been kept by Wilford's younger brother, who had died, and somehow Wilford had gathered Asel's papers. And as I was going through looking for something in the accounts, lo and behold, there's Azubah outlining her grievances. And it's also a day-by-day diary of, as they leave Connecticut, she's very excited, she's never been out of Connecticut, of the trip, of coming to Nauvoo, of her gratitude to her son for all he's doing for her. And then, you know, they hit muddy Iowa, and it's miserable. And what is wrong? Well, she mentions some other women who are in the Woodruff party. Woodruff has not taken, well, he's just sort of taken a plural wife here, Mary Jackson, but he's not admitted it yet. She is part of the party, someone they've brought from England. And then there are a couple of young women, a Sarah and a Miss King, who are helpers on the wagon. So I write, trying to keep some control over a limited supply of food, Phoebe had given this helper, Sarah, responsibility for dipping milk from the containers where it was stored after each milking. Milk cows driven along the trail were a major sort of sustenance for adults as well as children. The issue for Mother Woodruff was status. She felt demeaned by Phoebe's telling her that she had to ask Sarah for a bit of milk for her tea, when every night she slept in a tent with the milk pans all around her. Why couldn't she just reach out and take some milk? She felt demeaned by this. She knew how to care for milk. She knew how to make butter. She thought Phoebe ought to acknowledge her expertise and her good sense. Wilford, you will see at once, she writes, addressing her son, that you need not much discernment to see that your mother is required to take a lower seat than your servants. She found herself reduced to begging or to grabbing what she could like a hungry child. She began to sneak a little milk when she wanted it, and she snatched fresh bread from the box when Phoebe offered her a hard crust. But the very act of resisting diminished her in spirit. And I go on to talk about this and how this revealed a prior conflict between Phoebe and Azubah. It was very rough. Her husband had lost his mills in Connecticut. Most of her children had died, her own biological children. She had Wilford, and she had Eunice, and Eunice had kind of abandoned the journey west at this point. And there she is with Phoebe, and she just doesn't know if she'll ever command a kitchen again or a house. Living in a tent is more than she can handle. Well, it's a little insight into a larger phenomenon. As the saints came out of Nauvoo, having at a real high, having completed the temple, despite all the animosity around them and the troubles, they had had these temple ceilings and felt that, you know, this was going to be a great, God was going to take care of them. And then, having embraced polygamy in this moment of feeling that it was God's will, they then had to figure out how they were going to live it. There was no model, and they had no way to do it. And the story goes on and on, but Wilford Woodruff's first attempts to acquire plural wife, the first three attempts failed quite miserably. The fourth attempt, he married a convert from Boston who died within weeks. It took him a very long time to become a polygamist. Now, maybe that's because of Phoebe, who was not so thrilled with his practice. But I think it was also about the difficulty of learning how to live, which they eventually did. The four wives all lived together until they were resettled in different parts of his property, and he ended up with a very large family. But his mother left him, went back to live with her daughter Eunice. It not only broke up the relationship between Azubah and her son, but between Azubah and her husband, because Wilford's father went west to Utah and his mother did not. Now, we don't often hear these stories. They're common sense stories in families. Families have troubles. And when we layer those on, the kind of hardships that these people were experiencing, it's like Eliza Snow says, the worst suffering they had on Iowa was family discord. And I tell this story for two reasons. One, to suggest the fragility of women's voices. She wrote it in blank pages in her dead son's account book. And nobody really has used that because it's pretty hard to find. Many of the diaries barely survived. Eliza Snow's could have been burned up in a trash pile if a neighbor hadn't found it. The fragility of the women's records. But the second point is that when we talk about family in early Mormonism, we're talking about a whole lot more than marriage. We're talking about extended family relationships as well, and about the complexities of those themes. Okay. So I'm going to quit. My second story is, well, I'll give you one line from the second story, and then we can pick up in the question and answer if you would like to. And this is, so I've given you an example of my focus on relationships among women and men in the household. I just want to give you one that goes sort of beyond that to the position of women in the church. There's a lot in this book about the Relief Society, about the founding of Relief Society in Nauvoo, the disappearance of Relief Society when Brigham Young halted the Relief Society, said no more women's meetings, about what happened for the 2 decades that it took to restore that, and how women managed to work together collectively in an organized way, but not really in a general way, in a way in which they were logged into the structure of the church, remained quite informal and localized. And I talk about that, and I talk about the recovery of Relief Society. And this passage comes from the late 1850s, when there were these local little Relief Societies organized to provide clothing for the Paiute Indians, and then to provide carpeting for the old tabernacle. And on one day, Zina, in a little diary that's just barely readable, it's because it too was lost and in terrible shape when it was discovered. In her fragmentary diary, she described how in the midst of a heavy rainstorm, she, Elizabeth Whitney, and Eliza R. Snow met to share, these are her words, a heavenly exhortation in tongues by Eliza and a few words from an unworthy me. And one of the things that kept them going during that unofficial period where they were not allowed to really do much with Relief Society were these informal meetings with spiritual gifts, healings, blessings, and reviewing the Nauvoo Relief Society minutes and celebrating various events associated with the life of Joseph Smith. A few days later, Zina wrote, went over to see the president, that's Brigham, he's her husband, but went over to see the president about the Relief Society, met him in the new room. He greeted me with more kindness than he has for years. I truly feel to acknowledge the hand of God in all things, and help me, O Lord, to profit by all things. And she spelled profit, P-R-O-P-H-E-T. Very interesting little slippage. And this is the point in which they decide, in the point in which the church historians are recording the history of the church to be published in the Deseret News, they come to the point of the organization of Relief Society. And they take Eliza's minutes, and they write up the account of the early Relief Society. And they, as many of you know, this is well documented in the first 50 years of Relief Society, in the new volume, they rewrite it. They change what Joseph Smith said according to Eliza R. Snow's minutes. So, for example, when Joseph told them to place confidence in their leaders, meaning the officers of Relief Society who had just been set apart, the revision is place confidence in your husbands whom God has appointed for them to honor, and in those faithful men whom God has placed at the head of the church to lead his people. I won't go into more details, but part of the drama for me in this story that I'm trying to tell is how, bit by bit, they began to overcome that. And we could talk a long time about how they did that. And the Relief Society in the late 60s then was reinstituted with Eliza Archnow with heavy responsibility for reestablishing it. And so when there was that indignation meeting or that mass meeting in 1870 of women supporting polygamy, it was organized by the women's organizations led by the Relief Society. And they not only had a mass meeting in Salt Lake City, but they were in 58 towns in Utah Territory with really many. I mean, the Deseret News says 25,000. I'm not sure that's possible given the total population of the territory, but lots of people meeting in mass meetings organized by the women. So I'll let you ask for your money back or take the books home and learn more about these stories, but I'm trying to just give you a little sense of the texture of the book, which is about diaries, but about the kind of way relationships that these daily diaries can expose and help us understand. Okay? Sorry.
Okay, we've got a fair amount of time for questions, so I'll just let you moderate.
Okay. Can you stand up and speak loudly?
Yeah, so I come from a Mormonism where we were taught to write in our diaries for posterity.
Yes.
And that's... So when I wrote in my diary, I would sort of self-edit thinking, I could never let my kids know this. But why, I've been wondering why people in the 19th century, what was their idea about journaling? What did they think they were writing for?
Okay, what did people in the 19th century think about journaling? And what did they think they were writing for? I'll start with Wilford Woodruff. He titled his first volume of his journal, The First Book of Wilford. Do you think he'd been reading the Book of Mormon, maybe? Joseph Smith told the men who were called and ordained to go out to preach that what you speak when moved upon by the Holy Ghost is Scripture. So I have no doubt but what he thought he was writing of the dealings of God with mankind. But he told a group of missionaries, you don't need to write everything down. You don't need to write what you ate for dinner unless an angel came down and fed you. Then you put that down. But of course, he did include a lot of common life. He just couldn't help it. It's a fabulous diary. So Wilford tried to teach men, other men, over the long course of his career to keep diaries. And they did it the way lots of us keep diaries today. When they're on missions, they keep a diary. And when they come home, they stop. Women, we know why Asapa wrote. It was to record a journey that was new and exciting to her and then to record her complaints. So many diaries are efforts to, you take photographs, 19th century diarists wrote written accounts of travel and where they had been. And Zina Huntington, Jacobs, Smith, Young, Zina, her diary is a constant prayer. It's a spiritual diary, although she does include ordinary things in her life. Eliza's diary is episodic. She was never very good at doing it every day. She would insert her poems into her diary and eventually stopped prose entirely. And her little wonderful little album that Sarah Kimball gave her eventually becomes really a book of poetry. But they're dated and they're sequential. So I've used a lot of Eliza poetry, especially thanks to the wonderful addition of Jill and
Karen
Davidson, Karen Lynn Davidson's wonderful addition, which of the, if you don't have it, make, I'm sure Kurt can get you one of those volumes of Eliza's poetry.
Can I just do a little quick advertisement here? Wilford Woodruff is so central to this, and I'm happy to announce that Benchmark Books will be publishing the Wilford Woodruff journals probably sometime this year in association with Smith Pettit Foundation. So look for that and start saving up your pennies right now, because you can't beat Wilford Woodruff's journal, but we're working on it almost as we speak. So let us know if you're interested. It's going to not be $1.95.
Yeah,
I thought I would just sneak that in.
That is really, really, really good news. That is very good news. It's a wonderful, wonderful journal. Even if he left out a lot of stuff. Yes.
So I know as an educator, you share what you know with many audiences, and it's my understanding that there are many young people who, even if they are familiar with Mormonism or members of the Mormon Church, are unacquainted with the practice of polygamy, and it scandalizes them. So I don't know if you can help us understand why that might be so, and what you might tell someone scandalized by this historical fact.
Okay. I'll repeat the question as best I understood it, that she says she understands there are young people currently in the Latter-day Saint Church who don't really know much about polygamy and are scandalized by the idea, really upset about that idea. And she wonders if I can explain why that might be so, and maybe offer some comments on that. I find that so fascinating. When I discovered that people who had grown up in the church didn't know Joseph Smith had other wives, I thought, did any of them ever read the Doctrine and Covenants, section 132? I mean, I'm sorry, but my generation, I grew up very clear in my mind that I never wanted polygamy to come back. But people all around me said it was going to. That was a common kind of teaching in my generation. It's a higher law, and someday we're all going to have to learn how to sacrifice and practice polygamy. At some point, the church did stop talking about polygamy, and there are very complex reasons for that, that some of you can understand. But the fundamental point is, there is a whole generation or more who grew up not knowing about plural marriage. Worse than that, they grew up not knowing about women. Mm-hmm. So in some of those early volumes that were used as curriculum in priesthood quorums and Relief Society, the teachings of the different prophets, it's improved, but some of the early ones never mentioned wives. And that was because they had more than one. And nobody wanted to disturb people by thinking about that. It's a very sad thing. I'm not sure it was deliberate.
Of course it was.
But it just, maybe it was, ashamed of something that women in 1870 stood up and defend it. So I did not grow up with feeling scandalized at all about my ancestors. My father remembered his grandparents, and my mother remembered her grandmother who left the church over polygamy. You know, I grew up with a sense that some people embraced it and some people didn't, but I certainly knew it was there. But the church grew so rapidly, I think, after World War II, that a lot of that part of our kind of folk culture was really gone. And then there was the stigmatization of contemporary polygamists and a fear of being associated with them, and which is a whole sort of difficult story. Yes.
So this would be a corollary to the previous one. You've written this book for the general public. So my question is, what do you think the perception is of the general public as it relates to polygamy? And number two is, how do you put yourself into the reading public's mind to try and understand how to read or write that in a way that would be engaging to them?
Okay, there are two questions. I'll take the first one. How is this going to go over with the general public is the question. It's going to be kind of interesting to see. However, people liked Big Love. I mean, polygamy is kind of cool in certain dimensions because it's transgressive. Yeah, we've been rearranging and redefining the nature of the family legally through all of the processes with gay marriage, and many people believed, you know, the next issue is going to be polygamy. So there's a part of the general public that thinks that's the slippery slope and the horror story that can be used to get people to not support gay marriage. And there's the part of the general public that says consenting adults ought to have liberty to marry whom they choose. And the nation is divided on those issues. But believe me, there's definitely a part of the general public that's very interested in what was plural marriage. It's an international issue. It's a really significant issue. Is polygamy inherently abusive? Is a question sociologists debate. The Canadian Supreme Court debated it. These are hot topics today, which makes my publisher very happy, okay? Because it's something we're dealing with now. It's not just about the past. Okay, there's a hand back here.
Could you talk to us a little bit about how polygamous women defended the principle?
Okay, they defended, how did polygamous women defend the principle? In the indignation meeting, they defended it very much in terms of religious liberty. I'm, you know, one of the British women. Is this America, the land of liberty, that won't let me practice my religion? They defended in terms of you want the husbands to abandon their families. These are people we love. We support this. They defend it in ways that just seem so peculiar to us, you can't wrap your mind around it. And that is, in our little town, this is from one of those 58 towns, in our little town, there are no prostitutes. And when you think that the national public considered polygamy nothing but prostitution, you have to realize, okay, how are they thinking? And what they're thinking is, the nation is hypocritical because they condone illicit relationships. And then they want to come and punish us for taking care of our families, for choosing a way of life that we believe is sanctioned by God and, after all, is in the Bible. So this point about hypocrisy is extremely important in the defense. They made a big fuss at federal judge, one of whom they claimed, and I don't know if it was true, actually brought a prostitute with him to Utah and left his wife in Michigan. They, you know, really kept their eye on how people who were condemning them behaved in their own moral behavior. There's more than that, but those are a couple of thoughts. Yes?
I'm wondering how you make sense of some of the women like Emmeline B. Wells who kept two diaries,
uh-huh.
One a public and one a private, and had conflicting emotions.
Yeah, how do I make sense of people with conflicting emotions?
That's all of us.
So, I mean, two separate diaries, right? So she was presumably...
Emmeline Wells diaries. Emmeline kept a little diary in Nauvoo after her first husband disappeared. Emmeline then picked up diary keeping. I've got a pause a minute. Picked up diary keeping after my book ends.
Yeah.
So you have to ask Carol Manson. No, I'm joking. I mean, I don't write about Emmeline. There's a lot I don't write about because I'm in the early period. But I will tell you, and I work with much less fulsome materials, but there's some wonderful letters from Phoebe to Wilford, from Barbara Smith to G.A. Smith, when the men were down in Fillmore, attending the legislature when Fillmore was the capital. Thank you. And they say, Barbara writes to George saying, I met with Sister Woodruff and, you know, other people, and we discussed the polygamy principle from first to last, and we concluded that the men had the worst of it anyhow. And besides, we decided to let you have all the wives you wanted because we knew you would anyway. I mean, these letters are really interesting. They're teasing, they're joking. Of course they're conflicted. Absolutely. The late Kimball memoirs, her children's memoirs, claims she had a revelation. It's a wonderful story. It's in my book, and then I kind of debunk it because she was pretty miserable for a long time, and that those things are recorded. So I think we have to be really careful. Of course they were conflicted. They lived it. And some of them very happily. I mean, Margaret Smoot said it was a trial, but it was, she was never able to have children after her first child by her first husband, whom she abandoned, and then married Abraham Smoot. But she was mother to the children of the plural wives. That was a great, that was something that worked for some women very well, that this collective motherhood. Yes.
This is following up on the same point about the conflict.
Yeah.
But didn't Belinda Martin Pratt write a passionate defense of plural marriage, but then admit privately that her heart was broken by polygamy?
Oh, I don't know.
That's out of your period.
I don't know about that. Might have been later. Yeah. She wrote a passionate defense, and I find that just so normal.
But talk about hypocrisy.
No, I don't think, I don't see any of this as hypocrisy. I'm trying to think of a really good story I can tell you. The one thing I did not try to do in this book was defend polygamy or attack polygamy. Mm-hmm. I think our discussions of this topic, because they're so current and they're so weighted in terms of current policy and our relationships religiously, we tend to want to say, is polygamy good? Is polygamy bad? And if they really defended it, they really didn't mean it, or whatever. Seemed like that was a real dead end. So I loved Elizabeth Cady Stanton's comment. When she visited Utah in 1871, after the Utah Territorial Legislature gave women the vote, she said, the critics have got it all wrong. Monogamy and polygamy are both oppressive systems. And women will never be liberated as long as they are dependent on men for bread. So one of my chapters in the book the one with Caroline Crosby, is about women who are absolutely miserable in monogamy. And a number of the characters in the book, Belinda Pratt left her abusive husband in Boston or New England in New Hampshire in order to marry Peter. Augusta Cobb left her husband and five children in order to marry Brigham. And then wrote an amazing long list of letters, fabulously interesting letters, you know, fighting with Brigham. So it's where people are in their lives. Now, when you talk about standing up and publicly defending polygamy, which is, I think, what you're implying in terms of hypocrisy, how could you stand up there? You don't really mean that. You're not defending polygamy. Think of the position these women are in. Have you ever watched a Muslim woman who, with her headscarf tied in a knot under her chin? I, being president of the Harvard undergraduate student body, for example, and looked at them and thought, oh my, that's oppressed. She has to cover her head, which is the way people looked at Mormons. Oh, they're oppressed. Their husband must have made them do that. These women are both women and Muslims. These women were both women and Mormons. And the federal government wanted to come in and change their lives. They did not want to be rescued by people who did not understand or value their religion. And many left. My great-grandmother, she didn't leave her husband, interestingly enough, but she left the church, so my grandfather was never baptized. You could leave. Nobody was locking you in a prison. And there was no-fault divorce for polygamous wives. So I think we need to look at the context in which these statements are made. I think many did feel that they gained spiritual strength and self-discipline and self-mastery by doing something hard. That's the way they lived. That was a good 19th century value. And there were women who were miserable. Some left, some didn't. Yes?
I heard recently, and so clarify if I'm wrong or if the fact I heard is incorrect, that the no-fault divorce was specifically in cases when women wanted to leave their husbands in order to marry a leader in the church. That's
no.
not the case.
No.
Was it so it was common for women to leave their husbands not to marry another man?
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's plenty of evidence for that. The idea of being able to leave a husband to marry somebody higher, I think it probably happened. But no. And the divorce certificates are really interesting. It's the husband and the wife who divorce each other. And the ideas, I mean, Wilford's divorce, I write about in some detail in the book. I mean, they did not make each other happy. What does that sound like? Mm-hmm. Sounds extremely modern. Mm-hmm. Very interesting. I don't know who's next. Maybe way in the back in the blue shirt. Okay, can you stand up and say it loudly?
The women you studied register the visit of that French feminist, Audouard, I think?
Don, you know, I just couldn't hear. Who can repeat that for
did
me?
Did any of the women that you wrote about register the visit of the French feminist journalist?
No. I don't know when they came through.
She was fascinated by Mormons and polygamy and defended.
Well, fabulous story. No, anyway. I missed that one.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. Thank you for coming. Really enjoyed your time. This.
That was wonderful. What a treat for us.
You talked about all the
I neglected to give a nod to the publisher, Alfred A. Knopf, who's also given us Richard Bushman's Joseph Smith, Rough Stone Rolling, and dare I mention, No Man Knows My History, 1945.
And Great Basin
Been
Kingdom.
In print ever since. Great Basin Kingdom was no, Harvard.
Brigham Young.
Harvard.
Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, Brigham Young, the biography by Leonard Arrington. Anyway, they're to be commended too. When Laurel was saying that she kind of couldn't believe young people or others saying that they didn't know that Joseph Smith had plural wives, you know, haven't you read the 132nd section? Well, I want you to know my theory is that the best way to hide things from the saints is to publish them. There's not much danger that they'll be discovered. But you are exceptions to that rule, so thank you.